Hi, everyone. It's Plastic EP coming in from Melbourne, Australia. And let me tell you, we've got the greatest people on the show. How are you, Sabine? You're the rock chick. Introducer and new guest.
Yeah, coming in from Twickenham. Yeah, I'm feeling groovy, feeling fab. And welcome, Peter. Great honour to have you on our show. You've been very busy, I know, leading up to Christmas. Let us know all about your exhibits, your photography. And then we'll get to like the early days and being a roadie with Queen, because you must have so many stories.
Yeah, and not all of them can be published, but yeah, it was, you could say it was an interesting life I've had. So interesting.
Yeah, here we go.
That's fantastic. When did that come out, Peter?
That came out, I believe it was 2011. I believe late in 2000.
You're right.
Now show us the new edition, the new one with the new cover, and this came out October last year. Yeah, tell us a bit about that and how long it took to write.
Well, this one is basically, it's the book I always wanted to do. I mean, this is a picture book. I mean,
yeah, hardback version.
Hardback, yeah.
Yeah.
The book you have was basically my biography. I mean, it had some photos in, but that was basically my story. Whereas this one is just more of a visual journey from when I started and a little bit before Queen I talk about. And then it's my journey with Queen for 11 years through some copy and but mainly through photos.
Yeah. So how did you get to be the band's photographer?
Well, I was never the band's photographer. That's it. I mean, I always liked photography and used to take pictures, but I only had like a little Instamatic. And then it was, I think, when we first went to Japan in 75. And in those days, you could buy cameras much cheaper in Japan. So I bought a Nikon camera and a couple of lenses, and then just it became my hobby. And then I was around the band, and because they trusted me, they didn't mind me taking pictures. And after a while, they were like, "Oh, did you take some pictures?" And I said, "Yeah." "Oh, right. Well, can we use them?" "Yeah, okay." And that's how it sort of developed. And over the years, they got used to me having my cameras around. And then I mean, I was, if you like, commissioned, even though I was working for the band as a roadie, it was just like, "Well, we want you to do this. We want you." Fine.
Yeah. Well, they could trust you implicitly. And, you know, you were part of the family, weren't you, really?
I mean, it's very interesting because for a band that was so visual, they rarely ever had photographers around apart from live shows or a press call. But when we're in the studio, they would never allow anybody in, or rehearsals, or, I mean, even on video shoots, I ended up doing the stills for most of the video shoots. Yeah. So,
well, was that down to Freddie? Was that Freddie's kind of
A combination of all of them. I mean, Fred was obviously a very visual, creative guy. Mm-hmm. And after I actually left the band in 86, he commissioned me to do some of his solo work. I mean, I did some for the band, but mainly it was for Fred. And I think that's why when I said I was leaving, he understood, because I wanted to do something creative. I mean, if I'd gone to work for another band, he'd have never forgiven me. You know, he would have hunted me down probably and given me a good smack. But no, he kind of understood that I wanted to do something for myself, creative. And then, yeah, I had a career as an advertising photographer for a long time. So,
oh, wow.
That's how it. And then kind of when digital came in and photo libraries and kind of commissioned photography and advertising all changed with the internet and royalty free, and things slowed down. Mm. And then I just kind of found my archive and was just looking through images that to me were just things I took years ago, you know.
Yeah.
I started looking at them in a different way. And I actually had a big show in Australia in 2011 in Ballarat, which is outside
Yep,
Melbourne.
that's right. That's a big city town like Bendigo. That's one of the biggest there. That's where the gold mining town was as well. As I said, to take these candid shots of the band that was so relaxed, I'm sure that they're some of the greatest shots of the band being at their best and just being comfortable with you and not expecting any, like, no pressure. You're just shooting away, taking shots. It's like the Beatles, you know what I mean? To me, it's like that position.
I mean, it's interesting because recently in London, they had the Paul McCartney photographic exhibition to
I went to
reopen
that.
the National Portrait Gallery. And I went along, and it's Paul shots of the Beatles back in the day, and you know, George's mum, and they're just fascinating. And they aren't just snapshots. I mean, the guy obviously has a creative bit of creativity in him, you know,
Yeah, it was a fabulous exhibition.
and it was great. And I started to look at my stuff in a different way, because when you've taken it and years ago, and you think, yeah, all right. But it was the same when I did the show in Ballarat. I found images and thought, oh, that looks quite good, that picture of Fred. And people are like, why have you never printed it before? I don't know.
Absolutely love this, Peter. I just have to hold this up
Thank
because,
you.
look at that. That's stunning.
The
Can you
unseen
see?
coin. There you go.
Absolutely stunning. I mean, I went to Sotheby's,
Oh, yeah.
for the viewing. I didn't actually go to the live auction, and I really wanted something of Fred's because I'm a crazy cat person. He loved cats, and I wanted just something of his cat collection. But that waistcoat. Oh, I would have absolutely loved that waistcoat. But hey, I didn't even get a lucky cat. I just did not get lucky. How on earth did he amass so much? This is a thing. Well, he was 40 when he passed, but that he had people to go shopping for him in Japan or wherever. He amassed so many wonderful things. And I just want to show you because, it's just, again, look at that. I mean, I like to be surrounded by splendid things, Oh, Fred, honestly.
Well, he was like a magpie. I mean, he used to like shiny, glittery things. But I mean, he had really good taste. I mean, you know, I've been to his house many, many times. I mean, I actually went to his house after he died. Mary invited me, and I'd done a charity walk to help her raise some money for an AIDS charity. And I went to the house sometime after. Still the same. She kept it still the same. And you know, the probate stickers were still on all the
No.
art and stuff.
Yeah.
Freddie Mercury, to me, he's one of the greatest rock and roll singers ever. And I'll tell you why.
Oh,
He
yeah.
had such a powerful voice that never failed him. Like the power of
Oh,
his
yeah.
voice when he performed, there was no one like him. And the notes he could sing so high and so perfect and so clear, that's so hard to do.
Well, he could sing anything, I think, is the key. I mean, he could sing, you know, raucous rock and roll. He could scream at the top of his voice, but he could do really delicate ballads. And I think that was really shown and came to the fore when, after he passed, they had the tribute concert, and they had singers performing with Queen at Wembley, doing Queen songs. And not many, let's say, cut the mustard. Michael was terrific with Someone to Love, but so many you were like, okay. And I won't tell you who they were, but one or two. I mean, I came back out of retirement to help John Deacon, and we had to tune down, I had to tune his bass down for a certain song or two so that the singer could hit those notes, because he couldn't hit the high notes. It just shows you. I mean,
What do you think of Adam Lambert?
I'll be honest with you, I've never seen them together.
No, I haven't.
I believe he's a very good singer, and you know, the
But it's
guy,
not Freddie. And he says
yeah,
he
that's
has
fine.
his
That's
own
normal.
twist
That's
on.
like AC/DC, right? Angus, I mean, you know, Bon Scott. No one can be Bon Scott, but they can only come
No.
in, do themselves, be themselves, and contribute to the new sound of the band. Because what you've got to understand is when you replace a member of the band, it's never going to be the
It's
same sound. Singer can't be the singer that was before.
exactly. I mean, with AC, I mean, obviously, when Bon died and they got Brian Johnson in, I have to say that it was pretty. I mean, he was a great replacement because obviously he went on and they did some of their biggest albums. But if you listen to Highway to Hell and then you listen to Back in Black, yeah, Back in Black was bigger. But yeah, Bon had a unique voice. And I remember in 76, we were touring in Australia and we were in Adelaide. And Bon was one of the stage crew helping us hump the gear in and out. And he was still the same then. He was crazy and he was, you know.
What a character.
And that was back in 76. And a friend of mine actually worked for Angus for many, many years. And he used to carry Angus on his shoulders through the audience, you know, and he did all that. And the poor guy's got compressed vertebrae from
Oh,
carrying.
dear.
Carrying a small Scotsman on his back for many years. But,
You know, these are unbelievable stories. And you know, the great thing is, do you hope to do another exhibition shortly? Or is there something coming up you'd like to tell everyone
yeah, in the
about?
UK. In the
There's,
UK, Peter, please.
yeah, well, I mean, there's one on in big one in Rome at the moment, which is really good. And then it goes to Milan. The problem with the exhibitions is, you need sponsors, you need someone to back it. And in Italy, they get the support of the local city, the local council, the local regions. They get, you know, I mean, I had to do an interview in Rome a few weeks ago, and they said to Peter, and I speak Italian anyway, and they said, you've got to come and do this interview. I said, who's it with? They said, the post office. I said, you what? He said, no, they're the second biggest sponsor. They've given us.
Oh, right.
So I'm like, yeah, I'm here.
Yeah. I believe, if I'm right in saying that, that you did have an exhibition at Proud Galleries in London. Now, I
I
know the
did.
guys down there.
I did many years ago, yeah.
Yeah, would you consider having another one there? Because Brian
No, I
May's had
wouldn't.
his. Oh, okay. I'm only saying because Brian May had his 3D
Yeah.
exhibition there last year. So I just wondered that you would perhaps.
Not at Proud. I did have
No.
one when the book came out. I had one at Iconic Images, which
Oh,
is
I
in
can't. Yes, I know that one. Yeah.
huge place down in Piccadilly.
Yeah.
And
So it would be another venue then, would it, if you had another one in London?
I would say it would be at Iconic
Yeah,
because
Iconic Images. Yeah.
yeah,
Okay.
they
All
helped
right.
me get the book published. They have some of my prints, and it's such a wonderful space, and
Yeah,
they.
I'm going there this week actually.
Okay, is there an opening? Is that
It's a new one. So before it kind
okay?
of finishes, I want to get there. And but it would be great to see you down there this year, Peter, if you
Yeah,
can
no, I mean,
beat it.
I'm there sort of every now and again, but
Yeah. Oh,
I
we'll have to
also,
meet
yeah,
up.
but I live in Munich part of the time.
Yeah, how many times did you tour with Queen in Australia?
We did only two tours. It was in 76 and then again in 85. And people say, why didn't they come down? And there's rumors that Fred didn't like it, which I think is not totally true. I think the very first time they went, when I think it was about 74, and they played Sunbury, they did some
Yeah, that's
festival.
right. A rock
Yeah.
festival out there
And
in the
Fred
state.
got a hard time. He got strip searched and all this kind of thing, et cetera.
I
Anyway,
understand.
we did the tour in 76, Night at the Opera. But it was also the fact that to put in Australia with a tour, unless you're going to the Far East, the costs were just phenomenal.
Yeah, but I've got to say, Australia loves Queen, and what their biggest fan base is here in Australia.
I know, absolutely. I mean, they were huge, but yeah, we toured the Works tour, and cause, I mean, Molly Meldrum was a huge, huge fan of Queen, and you know, supported them a lot. And yeah, I mean, it is a shame, but a lot of it was logistics, money, whatever, bad management decisions, let's say. So
Yeah.
yeah.
Now, I read something that in your first book that let's hold this up again. I mean, Queen had a lot of famous, well, other musicians who are fans and actors too, like the Fonz, like Henry Winkler. I read
Yeah,
that, you
that's right.
know, and yeah, that's really interesting that, you know, I mean, Fonz, we've had Don Most on our show, Ralph Mouth, recently. But it's always interesting to hear that who goes along to the shows or, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, in LA, I mean, John Hurt, the actor, used to come along, and all kinds of people. I mean, it was, and Madison Square Garden, you'd have, Andy Warhol would be in the dressing room,
Wow.
taking pictures of the band with a little Instamatic. And so, yeah, they did have that kind
Wonderful.
of allure and magic about them. So, yeah, I mean, it's.
And so there must be lots of funny stories from touring days, I can imagine. Just tell us a little bit about the Scrabble that Freddie used to play. I know you can't say, I mean,
Scrabble.
but it was his version of Scrabble, wasn't
Well, I
it?
mean, he was obsessed with playing Scrabble, and he told me that when he was young, he played it with an aunt, and used to, I don't know, hone his skills with this aunt. Anyway, so when we're particularly in the studio and there's a lot of downtime, we would play Scrabble, and I remember we were in Munich, and there wasn't a Scrabble set. And he said, "I want a Scrabble set." I said, "All right, Fred, no, I want one now." So I go off to some, games emporium in Leopoldstrasse and come back with a Scrabble set. Of course, it's in German. And he says, "What the fuck can I do with all these umlauts and X's? And what am I going to spell? Obergruppenführer, get me a real set." So anyway, someone from the office went to Hamleys in Regent Street,
Right.
was couriered out at huge expense, so Fred could play Scrabble. And he didn't like to lose, I can tell you that. He wanted to win, and he was very good. And then we had a rude word Scrabble, whereby you could only put down words or phrases or, kind of abbreviations
Oh, that's Freddie. Yeah, that's so Freddie. Yeah. I
naughty, naughty things. And he was quite good at
that.
that as well. So,
When did you actually first meet the band and get employed with them?
Well, I first met them when they were support to Mott the Hoople. And it was in November 73. And down, not far from where I live, down North End Road in Fulham, there used to be an old cinema. And Emerson, Lake and Palmer bought it and turned it into a rehearsal space, ripped out all the seats in the stalls. And it was where everybody used to rehearse. And I'd worked with Bowie before, and it's where David rehearsed. Wings did, Zeppelin did, Jethro Tull had offices. It was just the place, but it was pretty dank and miserable. Anyway, we're there rehearsing, and we got the lighting rig fired up because it's so cold. There was no heating, these big gas heaters. And then we're told the support act is coming in. So, okay. And they were a band called Queen. No one had ever heard of them. So anyway, they get their little go on stage, and we're all in big coats and scarves and woolly hats, and Queen come in their ladies' blouses and silk and satin tight trousers.
Flamboyant.
They start going for it, and Fred's like up on stage as if it's a proper show. And we're like, who is this Wally? Who does he think he is? Can't have a rock star called Fred. They'll never make it. What a bunch of posers. No, get them off, And I was wrong about that, that's for sure. So, it's funny because, as I said, it is now Waitrose Supermarket where Manticore was. And I reckon I first met Fred somewhere around the fr where the frozen foods aisle was, so probably, he'd probably prefer that I met him near the fine wines and champagne. But
The position within the band, the trust to be a roadie and then be with them for 11 years. Like, how did that actually happen?
What happened was I was working with Mott, and Queen on that tour, they learned a lot from Mott the Hoople because Mott were a big band, and they were reasonably big in America. And then after the UK tour, the following spring, Mott went to the States, and Queen supported them doing some shows in the States. And they were the first band Mott to play on Broadway. They played at the Eurus Theatre in Broadway. So Queen were kind of learning their craft, if you like, in under the wing or in the shadow of Mott to a degree. And Ian Hunter was a good front man. And Ariel Bender was exciting. And they had some great songs. Anyway, so there was this connection that built up between Mott and Queen. And then I think it was about a year afterwards, I was offered a job. And it was to be Brian's roadie because they knew me from Mott. And I said, yeah, okay, well, I've met Brian and I do guitars. I was Mick Ronson's roadie. But then, because his roadie had quit. Anyway, his roadie decided to come back, I don't know, over £5 or a cup of tea and a sandwich or something, I don't know. So he said, well, there's another job going, doing drums. And I said, I'm not a drum roadie. I don't do big, you know, like big Meccano sets. I don't do drums. So that was it. But then about 6 months later, the guy finally left and so did one or two other people. And they wanted a whole new crew. And Mott and all the different incarnations of Mott, Hunter, Ronson, they kind of all faded. And basically, we were looking for a job. And I was still the youngest. I was 19 or maybe 20. And the other guys were about 5 years older, more experienced. And they said, okay, well, Richie can do Brian's guitars. Phil can do the drums. And we'll have someone to look after stage right, look after Fred and John. And that was me. So he said, oh, yeah, get the young kid in. He can do that, you know. And that was it. And I started when they were recording Night at the Opera and was in and out of the studios, moving stuff around. And
pretty exhausting, Peter.
It was. But, I mean, we were young then, you know.
Yeah. Had the energy.
you just had the energy. And because it was an adventure. Yeah. And you loved it. It didn't matter.
Don't worry about lack of sleep, lack of.
Yeah, but this is like, it's never going to happen again. Like Peter's life with the band and the photographs, right? Are like going to be timeless forever. And I've got to ask you, Bohemian Rhapsody was one of the biggest songs here in Australia. Did you take photos of that session?
No, because I didn't have a camera then, unfortunately. So I mean, I was there when it was recorded. I was there when the video, and I mean, we were hearing little bits of it in different studios. I mean, the band had just signed with John Reed, who was Elton's manager. And you know, we're pushing on. If Bo Rap and Night at the Opera hadn't been a success, there's a real chance I think EMI would have dropped the band because they'd had some success, but not anything like what they should have. Anyway, Fred wanted, you know, this 6 minute single and he got his way.
Thanks to Kenny Everett playing it.
It was Kenny playing it. Absolutely, on Capitol. And you'd hear something in one studio and you hear something in the other. And I remember hearing the opera bit and thinking, bloody hell, what's that all about? Is it some kind of introduction tape for the show?
Yeah.
And then I heard the whole thing and I thought, blimey, I don't know about this. But anyway, I've got the gig for the tour and I'm on £40 a week. So it's like, at least I've got a job for the next 2 months or whatever.
Yeah.
And yeah, and then it sort of grew on you and grew on everyone else as well.
I was at college when it hit number one for 9 weeks. And I was just at college in Basingstoke. I remember that vividly.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I've got one of the limited edition ones, the blue vinyl ones, which there was one that was sold at Sotheby's. It was Freddie's own one, I think number 2 of 200. And he gave me one. Now, I've got 187 or something like that.
Yeah. You mentioned Bowie, and of course, today's his heavenly birthday today, and Elvis's too. But my birthday was just 2 days ago, so I'm a Capricorn as well. David, you've taken pictures of David as well, have you
I'm
not?
Sorry.
You've taken pictures of David Bowie.
No, I didn't. I didn't have a camera then. I've got a few pictures, old Instamatic things of Mick Ronson and when he had when he went solo, I worked for him. And he had a Trevor, the bass player, was still with him. Mike Garson, the piano player.
Right.
He had, three backing singers. He had a sax player. We did a UK tour.
Right.
say 6 months after that, he ends up joining What the Hoople. So, but lovely, the loveliest guy you'll ever meet, Mick Ronson. I mean,
yeah, I've met Susie and Maggie.
Well, Susie's just got a book coming out.
Has she? Well, there you go, classic. We need to get Susie on the show.
Me and Mr. Jones, I think it's called.
Right. I'll message her. Thank you for that.
Susie's lovely. And because sadly, from that era, not many people around.
I know. I tell you who else you just reminded me of, Woody Woodmansey. He signed my Sticky Stardust album at the Camden Walk of Fame 2 years ago when we had Bowie's plaque unveiling. We've got to have a few more unveilings this year, and I'm suggested that we need to get Queen a plaque going on there in Camden, because we had 11 unveilings last year. So
if you can just hold up your book for everyone out there and just tell them now, obviously it's for sale everywhere on the net, but just show us the book one more time.
Yep, the book Queen Uncovered. And I actually had a message about a week ago from someone in Melbourne who found it in a bookstore. And she'd done some articles when I was in Ballarat doing the show in, I think it was 2011. And that was before the first book came out. And so it is being promoted in Australia.
I can tell you it's with the biggest Australian distributors for sale. I can tell you that now. But what I'm saying, Peter, is that's going to be a worldwide seller for you. All success to you. And if they can get the copy of the first book again, pick that one up as well. Right. Just show us again, Sabine.
Yeah, and we always ask for links, Peter. So if you could give us an order link for both books, or,
you can
they find
buy both
details
on Amazon, definitely.
Right.
And so you can get those worldwide on Amazon. But I think if you wanted a signed copy, Iconic Images. So
hopefully we'll get to meet at some stage this year.
I can sort that out for you. So
and if you ever come to Australia, just let us know again. And if you're doing an exhibition down here, I'll come and meet up. And I just want to say, we want to support you as much as we can, because to me, it's mind blowing being with Queen for 11 years. I mean, that's a story.
Thank you.
In itself. And only you can tell it through the book, which is fantastic. We want to thank you for being on the show. And we thank you so much. We want everyone out there to go and buy your book.
Well, that's very kind of you. I appreciate it.